Penguin Audiobooks presents The Deep End of the Ocean by Jacquelyn Mitchard. Read by Dana Ivey.
Altogether, it was 10 years, easily 10, from the hot August morning when Beth put the envelope full of pictures into the drawer, until the cold fall afternoon when she took them out and laid them one by one on her desk. 10 years and change, actually. The previous summer had marked a full year since Beth had learned what happened to her son Ben. And if she counted the whole spiraling spectacle of what came after, it was really closer to 11. She stared at the driveway picture, wishing she had her good photographer's loop. There was Jill, Pat's college-age cousin who lived with them then and helped out while she went to school, carrying Beth's cameras and bags. Jill with long hair, looking like a sunny little hippie. There was Carrie, 6 months old, a minuscule infant face above a dress bordered with red and blue and yellow boats. Vincent had still been blonde. Beth couldn't remember her older son with his brown mat, lush and coarse as bear fur, ever having been blonde. But Ben's face, that was a blur. Poised to receive that face like sacrament from the drawer bottom, she saw instead not much of anything. She saw details. How very many freckles he'd had on his arms. How long and enormously well-muscled his legs were, even then. But his face was blurred. You could tell his mouth was open. He'd been talking. But his features were indistinct. There was no message, no trace of the hint she'd expected. Even changed as she was on the molecular level, all her old beliefs discarded, she had still somehow expected it. Beth had been a newspaper photographer and photo editor for more than 10 years, so she'd seen many photos of people who later came to trouble. Soldiers in fresh uniforms with raw shaves, immigrant families at the metal rails of ships in layers of clothes, their luggage beside them on the deck. Cowboys, aviators. In those muddy images, she thought sometimes that she saw a hint, a foreknowledge of the mishap to come. The clue, she fancied, was the look in people's faces. A vulnerability? A message of departure in the photo grain? Beth had once put stock in such things. She had a whole history, a life structure set up on luck, dreams, and hunches. And it all went down like dominoes in a gust on the day Ben disappeared. All Beth's forebodings about the picture were simply the result of letting one thought based so long, it seemed true simply by virtue of having lasted. Like the immigrants, the aviators, and the cowboys, like all those pilgrims. The two women and three children on the suburban porch, framed by a bower of rather faded lilacs, had no idea of the destiny toward which they were pointed. There had been no warning. There never was any, at all.
I only like the baby, Beth sighed as she and her husband stacked plastic bags and diaper bags and duffel bags and camera bags and Beth's big old backfold reflector all in a pile in the hall. She was surprised when Pat looked at her with disgust. She knew he didn't want to fight, didn't want to make trouble on the verge of clearing the whole tribe out for a weekend. It was foolish in the extreme, according to Pat, her plan to take all the children to Chicago, attend her 15th high school reunion, and shoot a job. Vincent wanted to go to the restaurant with Daddy. He told Beth so this morning 8 times.
You cannot go to the restaurant with Daddy, she finally snapped at him.
Wondering if she would actually lay hands on him if she heard his wheedling voice just one more time, Daddy will be working.
I can sit quiet in the back, Mom. I did it that one time.
It had been the peak experience of Vincent's life thus far, going to spend a Saturday night with Pat at the restaurant he managed for his Uncle Augie.
Vincent, we plan to go all together to Chicago, and you'll see Aunt Ellen, and I need you to help me watch Ben and Carrie. But, Mom, I hate Ben and Carrie, and I hate that I have to do everything, and I'm not even going to get dressed.
Vincent wasn't forgiving. Ben was. He was delighted to be going out of town with his mother and his brother that morning, as delighted as he would have been to go to the hardware store or sort mixed socks. Ben wasn't just accommodating. He simply expanded with great good humor and faith to fill any space you put him in. But even his charm was wearing thin today. Ben had taken all the medicine and makeup out of Beth's bags and lined the bottles up like toy soldiers against the door. She stepped on a bottle, cracking it, and vitamins exploded everywhere.
God damn it!
She stumbled. And when Pat arrived, gracefully, to help her, she told him the momentary truth. She liked only Carrie, who was unformed, dependent in simple ways, and couldn't even sit up. Pat picked up a medicine bottle. Just get on the road, Beth. They'll settle down. They'll go to sleep. So she and Pat dragged everything out to the Volvo and strapped Carrie and Ben into their car seats and got Vincent and Ben out again to make sure they went pee and had their toothbrushes, when Pat suddenly remembered he wanted to finish the roll of film from their camping trip. They stood in the bower the lilacs formed. Pat snapped. Beth leaped into the driver's seat. She didn't kiss him. She'd see him in 2 days anyway. In fact, she'd see Pat before the sun went down, Beth later recalled. The drive down Route 90 to Chicago was never a pleasure. She and Pat used to have some petting fun in their old Chevy Malibu years before, coming home from college for Christmas, to families who were speechless with delight that the two of them were in love. These days, it was simply what it was, a stupid, boring, flat farms and then suburban sprawl shot for 150 miles. They made the trip often because all the members of both their families lived in the Chicago area. Pat and Beth had belonged to each other from junior year at the University of Wisconsin, and even in a sense before, as the children of parents who didn't consider it a holiday unless they played poker together. Pat and Beth had played with each other at picnics or in friendship emergencies. They went to each other's first communions, to each other's high school graduation parties. But they never really saw each other as gendered, until the day they ran into one another on the library mall in Madison, 3 hours before they fell into bed at Pat's attic dump and missed the next 2 days of classes. He wasn't handsome, not even when he was young. He had a wide, white smile and straight teeth. Perfect collusion, he called it. But he was short and slight, with unruly curly brown hair and face-saving huge eyes. His shoulders were broad, but his legs were skinny, almost bowed. Pat looked waifish, starving, and was so uncomfortable around people, so eager to please them, that they believed he was the friendliest guy they ever met. But it had been she, not Pat, who had gotten up from the hard bed more than a dozen years ago, certain they'd marry. She knew at last she was safe. Beth hadn't asked Pat to the dance and dinner that would form the centerpiece of her reunion. He knew plenty of her old Immaculata crowd. He'd been 2 classes ahead of her at the same school. He would have been welcoming to her friends. Pat was, Beth believed, probably among the most entirely cordial people in America. But he would have found the jokes stiff, the friendliness forced, the opportunities for telling old stories and dishing old enemies meaningless and cruel. Beth, on the other hand, couldn't wait. She thought about tonight, all the people from the neighborhood she'd see, who'd all be more wealthy than she, but not so creative, nor so good-looking, and certainly not possessed of so many lovely children.
Good-looking, thought Beth.
I'm good-looking, not pretty, but objectively speaking, a solid 7 on the scale. When Beth thought about her own appearance, the word that came to her mind was square. She had square shoulders, across to her until they became fashionable, and a square chin. Even Beth's hair, when she let it hang of its own considerable weight, was square. And so, to her continuous despair, were her hips. Beth's own looks could never hold a candle to Ellen's, though Ellen, her childhood best friend, had spent 20 years telling Beth, "No one ever looks at your butt, Bethy. They never get past the bewitching green eyes." Ah, Ellen. From Beth's point of view, the whole point of this reunion weekend was Ellen. Ellen was waiting for her at the hotel. Ellen, who lived in the same West Side neighborhood where all of them had grown up, a street over from the house Beth's father still owned. Ellen had booked a room for the two of them, and a room for Jill and all the kids. She left her husband, her son, and a thawed tuna casserole up at her northern suburban mini-mansion, and bought a fancy black rayon dress. She'd sent Beth a drawing of it in the mail. The prospect of the weekend had reduced both of them to 17. "I think if Nick asks us to sit with them, we should," Ellen wrote on the bottom of the drawing. "His wife won't mind. After all, you fixed them up." Beth's first love, the most beautiful boy she'd ever seen before or since, the memory of whom could still make her abdomen contract, often ran into Ellen and her brothers, and occasionally worked with Ellen's husband on development contracts. Beth hadn't seen Nick for 10 years. She'd wondered then, as she often did, if she should have married him. Beth herself had introduced Tricia and Nick at the Feast of Our Lady of Mount Carmel when they were both 21. After an hour, there was no turning back. When Tricia married Nick, Beth stood up in the wedding, got drunk, and threw up on her beige organdy dress. She wouldn't throw up any more, but Beth wanted to get drunk with Ellen, get drunk and giggle and whisper and rush to the bathroom as if they had important things to conference about in there. She wanted to forget until Sunday that she had children and a cesarean. By the time Beth had eased the wagon under the portico of the Tremont Hotel on School Drive, Ellen was on her, tugging her shoulder, trilling, "You're here! You're here!" "I don't even know if they still have my reservation." "They do, Beth. I stuck it on my card." Beth was horrified. "Ellen, you can't do that." Ellen had money. Everybody in construction was loaded, as far as Beth could tell. And though it was Pat's dream to someday own part of the restaurant, and Beth's to someday own her own business, they were lean now. They'd been lean as long as they could remember. Ellen paid at restaurants when they ate together. She sent Carrie savings bonds as if the country were at war. But there were times Beth balked. "You can't pay for me, Ellen." Ellen shrugged. "You're going to have to go up there in that mess and arrange it then." They straggled into the lobby. It was jammed. Virtually all the out-of-towners who'd come back for the reunion were registered there. Beth almost gave up. Ellen leaned toward Beth conspiratorially. "I saw Cecil Lockhart. She looks just like Gloria Swanson now. She has white hair. On purpose." The antique flicker of annoyance Beth still felt at the mention of Cecil Lockhart's name took her by surprise. She realized that she'd been hoping that Cecil, the swan-like, gray-eyed girl who grew up next door to Ellen, would skip this occasion. Cecil, whose real name was Cecilia, was, Beth judged, the only of the Immaculata graduates from her year to have made more of herself as a creative soul than Beth had. And it rankled. Cecil taught acting at the Guthrie in Minneapolis. She was very much married. Cecil was, Ellen told Beth now, still a size 6 with a belt. Ellen knew. She'd seen Cecil last year at an arts ball. Cecil had had the distinction of being the first of them to ever have sexual...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.